Hello and welcome to this special edition of the program Arise Africa. I am Adesua Omoruan, and we will be getting the views of top analysts on the implications of the COVID-19 pandemic, the extension of the lockdown in Nigeria, as well as the ripple effects so far. From Ibadan, renowned infectious disease specialist Professor Yewole Tomori will be joining us online to take a look at the security implications. Two top security analysts, Kabiru Adamu in Abuja and Seyi Adetayo here in our off-site studio in Lagos, will be with us. And for the economic implications, as well as a general overview, Arise News analysts Bode Oshosami and Emmanuel Efeni will share their perspectives as well. And from around Nigeria, Arise senior correspondents Tokunbo Yetunji and Chima Nwankwo will be giving us live reports to fill the polls of Nigerians. Kickstart the special program now. The lockdown in Nigeria over the coronavirus pandemic has been extended by another 14 days. And announcing the decision in a broadcast, President Muhammadu Buhari said the very difficult decision was taken, knowing fully well that it would severely disrupt livelihoods and bring undue hardship. However, he says such sacrifices are needed to limit the spread of COVID-19 in the country and necessary to save lives. Well, according to the president, the objective was and still remains to contain the spread of the coronavirus and to provide space, time, and resources for an aggressive and collective action.
And having carefully considered the briefings and report from the presidential task force and the various options offered, it has become necessary to extend the current restriction of movement in Lagos and Ogun states, as well as the FCT, for another 14 days, effective from 11:59 p.m. on Monday, 13th of April, 2020. I am therefore once again asking you all to work with government in this fight.
Well, COVID-19 is fast moving from a health crisis to an economic crisis. But first, it's a global health pandemic. So let's talk about the health angle. As a renowned infectious disease specialist, Professor Oyewole Tomori joins me now from his residence in Ibadan, Oyo State. Thank you so much, Professor Tomori, for joining us. Quite a great deal to have you join the program at this time. You had the president yesterday.
Pleasure.
Nigeria cannot ramp up testing, daily testing, to 1,500. Over 7,000 health specialists have been trained. We have over 7 labs to test for this virus. But what are we doing wrongly, if anything, in your own opinion?
Thank you very much. We are not testing enough. In spite of what the task force is saying, we are not testing enough. And we're limited by the amount of testing kits we have, by the number of labs that are testing. And that's why we're having a problem. If we're limiting ourselves to just those people who have contact with cases and showing symptoms, then we're not testing enough. You know, it's been shown at least 20-30% of those who have the infection will not show the symptoms, but they are positive. And so unless we know the total number of people as much as possible, of those who have the disease, then we won't know who they are contacting. Then we won't be able to go around and know who we're going to trace. So we need to test more. Yes, the CDC is doing its best by, you know, wrapping up, getting up more samples, more laboratories to test, but we need much more than that. And it's not that we don't have laboratories in this country that can do it. There are enough laboratories which have been used for other projects, like the HIV group and all those things. Those same labs can be upgraded to run the test. There are about 200, 300 of them in different parts of this country. If each of those people are testing, then we'll know exactly the number of people that we have that are positive in this country. And if we know that number, then we'll know who and who to contact. We'll be able to follow up properly more than what we are doing.
Well, Professor, beyond the number of tests we are able to do, could this also be a factor of the demand, like we heard the national coordinator of the Presidential Task Force say, we're not having enough demand for those to be tested? Could it also be a factor of the case definition, national definition has stipulated that you have to have symptoms to get tested? Or is it just more than all of this?
It is a combination of that. First of all, our case definition limits us. There are two things that are limiting us, the case definition, and secondly, the amount of reagents that we have, testing kits we have. We just got donations from JAKIMA and also the WHO. At this stage in our life, Nigeria should not be depending on donations. Nigeria should take money out of its pockets and buy kits. And if they said there are not enough kits or there are not whatever, we can go around. WHO has given a list of tests that can be used. Let's go out and purchase those things and test our people. That we know exactly what is the number of cases we have. We're talking of 300 and something. I think we have much more than that.
Let's talk specifically about this virus, Professor Tomar, because you understand this a lot more. There's a problem health authorities in Nigeria are beginning to clamor. That's the problem of community transmission. How big of a deal is this for Nigeria? Because we did close our international airspace almost 3 weeks ago, but we are having people coming down with those symptoms and the virus as at today.
Well, let me say from onset that the problem that we have is that, as you said, we've closed our borders. So where are the cases coming from? They're not coming from outside. They're coming from within us. And the point is, if you look at the time when we had the first lockdown, I think we had about 131 cases. At the end of the 2 weeks of the lockdown, we moved to 343 cases. The two epicenters, Lagos and Abuja, have had almost doubled the number of cases they have. So somewhere, if they're not coming from outside, they must be coming from within inside. So there's community transmission going on. And those are the things that we need to test more people. The more of this that is happening, the more we need to improve up our testing. It's been how many months now that this issue has started? By now, our laboratories, if you said this at the beginning that we don't have enough laboratories, yes, I agree. But it's been 2-3 weeks, months, whatever, that this thing has started. By now, all those labs should be in place. It is not as if we are going to build new labs. These are labs in existence. All we need to do is upgrade them. I think time has come for us in this country to make use of what we have. There are people, laboratory people, who are all over there ready to come in out and do work for this country. Let's make use of them. Let's make use of the money we're getting. We are hearing of so many donations coming in. What are we using the donation for? This is one important aspect of that we should use. Take that money, buy more kits, train your people, get the tests done. Then we'll know, what the magnitude of our problem.
And that brings me to my next question on the human resources and the capacity that you have just mentioned. We do have epidemiologists in Nigeria. We do have the resources. How soon can we get this up to task to ensure that Nigeria begins to do that testing, which everybody says is the best way to know and understand what exactly we have on our hands?
First of all, there are a lot of experts in this country, and not all of them can be on task forces. There are many of them that can be used in the field, a lot of field experts. People have experiences. We have been there, years ago, who know how to do this. And we're wrapping up, we're testing people, we train people. It's within a week, if you have enough people out there doing the training, you can send them back to those people. In fact, these people don't really require that much training because they've been running these tests. In fact, there's a study paper I have. Some of the network we have did about 1 million samples last year for HIV testing. And they did about 500,000 to look at the viral load testing. These are people who have been there. They don't require that much training. You just give them the kit and they'll do the work. Give us a week to run around, get as many people out, all those who are in their retirement, who are locked up in front of this, bring them out of this country. We can train enough people in this country within a week and get all those labs back in operation.
to take you back to the virus again, Professor Tomori, because the National Coordinator for the Presidential Task Force, Dr. Aliyu, yesterday at the daily briefing did mention that you want to test to find the virus. And this tricky virus, if you do not have the symptoms, you might not come out positive, even though you are infectious. Is that possible? Explain to us what exactly Dr. Aliyu was talking about there.
Yeah, actually, to up to a point, there's a time when you can get, there's a period. I mean, if I get infected now, we're told it's about anything between 1 to 14 days before you show your symptoms. That means somebody can show symptoms in 2 days. Somebody can show symptoms in 3 days or up to 14 days. So any beginning to test me, you don't have to wait for my 14 days. My showing symptoms may be within 2 days. So if we already have a pool of people who have had contact with people who already are positive and we test them, yes, we're going to miss quite a lot of them, but we'll catch many more than we're catching now. So it's a balance of the two. I mean, I'm not saying go and do community testing. I'm saying anybody who has had contact with a positive case, whether it's showing symptoms or not, test that person. That's what we're saying. And remember, the result you get out today is the result of somebody's infection, maybe 2 weeks before. And if you are taking that long to let him know that he is positive, how many people has he contacted? Where has he been? The closer we are to detecting this, the more we can focus on, okay, if you get me now within a day or two, then you can trace my movement within the next 1 or 2 days, which hotel have I been to, which place have I been to. If you're waiting for 14 days, you can imagine how extensive that would be. That's why we're having problems with community transmission. Until we test and test and test, and find out those who are positive and put them in isolation, we would not get to the end of this problem.
Indeed, it is a fantastic and noble idea that we test as much as we can. However, it is no hidden fact that testing kits are in short supply globally. However, Nigeria was one of the first African countries, if not one of the first countries, to have a genome sequence for this virus to understand what exactly the virus is. Is it possible that we begin to develop our own testing? Because the molecular labs and the PCR machines, turnaround rates for tests is quite slow.
It depends. It's not that slow. It depends on the load you are putting on the labs, for example. If you have enough labs around and you're giving me 500 samples to test, of course, my turnaround time will be slow. If we ask Lagos, you have any labs you have in Lagos? We have 3 and 2. The analysis, each of those labs, how many samples are they testing? How many is each one testing? If you're overloading one, of course, you have a big problem with turnaround. If you are evenly distributing this and people are working assiduously, then we have a shorter time of period of turnaround. How many of the 7 or 8 labs that we have in different countries, how many of each of them testing? These are issues that we need to look at. These are analysis that we need to do to ensure that there's no overloading of any particular lab, so that lab does not end up giving problems with turnaround time. We need to get proper analysis, monitoring of all the labs. Where are the samples going? When did the samples arrive? When did they get your return test? Those are the details we need to be working out about. Not only that, when those samples are coming, get the proper information about the person. Where has he been? What's the age? What areas have been? What his travel is? Then it's not just lab results. They're combining that with the epidemiological report to be able to let you focus your tracing, your contact tracing, in a much better way. The earlier you catch them before they become problems in the public, the earlier you can stop this thing. We're talking about flattening the curve. We are not flattening no curve. Yes, we're not testing enough, and we're getting these large numbers. We started with 131 when the lockdown was put in. We are now at 343. Each of them have multiplied double the number that they did before the lockdown. If we continue at the rate of this thing, we'll continue to get more lockdowns in this country unless we do what is right and what it needs to be.
Okay, but Professor Tomori, my question really was, can we begin to develop our own testing kits? We do know that America, the FDA, has just approved one rapid test kit. With the genome sequence that we have of this virus, is it possible that Nigerian scientists can then develop our own test kits?
Fantastic. You raised a very important point, and I agree very much with you. It will take us some time. We'll have a little bit of problem, but everybody has problems. Remember when China used to make things in the initial stages? We used to laugh at them. Today, now we're all depending on China. If we don't start making those reagents, we'll never get to the end. And let me remind you, years ago, we're making our own reagents in this country for all the tests we're doing, for yellow fever, for any of the viral disease in the Ibadan lab. We did our own testing, we did our own reagents, we produced our own antibodies. But then we abandoned all that because our country had oil and we forgot everything that makes us sense. Now the other countries are reaping the benefits of investing in science. Nigeria abandoned science, disdained science, forgot their scientists, and now we are begging and begging everybody in the world. Simple thing that we need to do. We're even investing in kits to, I mean, what do you call it, cutting plugs to take samples in this country. That's the way we have left our people, and that's where we have left our country. We'll continue to do that until we look inwards and do what needs to be done. Yes, we cannot, it may not meet the current situation, but we can lay the foundation now for the next coming epidemic. Nigerians will be able to produce this. The lab in makes the genetic sequencing. Mm-hmm. It's the first we have. In fact, the whole of the African region may be using that one for other African countries. And yet we in our country, we're not using that lab. That's the problem that we have in our country. We disdain our own. We have no respect for our own. And that's where we are today.
But Professor Tamari, you would agree with me that when it comes to preventing or responding to COVID-19, there's no one-size-fits-all for countries globally. While some have adopted testing, we've seen those who have just adopted herd immunity. When you look at Nigeria's situation, it has been criticized that this is not tailored locally to respond to COVID-19, when you talk about social distancing and physical distancing and staying at home, that cannot work. When you look at the strategy that Nigeria has adopted, do you think that it was tailored locally? And what would you be advising the health authorities to do differently at this time?
There are two sides to this story. A good example is a country like Sweden. They're not locked down. And when their minister was asked, why do you lock down? He says, my people are disciplined. They understand the problem. When we tell them don't go out, they will not go out because they value their life. That is the difference. They are working together with their government, and they got to that one. Nigeria, the government says do this. We said no, we won't do it. Well, it's not really a major problem because, I mean, the problem is the fact that we have had the government that have lied to us all the years long. We don't believe them. We don't trust them. And so whenever they tell us anything, that is what we are paying for right now. We continue, I mean, the countries that are locked down, they also have other systems. If you are locked down, take the university system in some of the other countries. Where they are locked down, they're doing teaching online. Can Nigerian university do teaching online? Except for the high cost secondary schools in Lagos that are doing that kind of thing. Our university system cannot even do teaching online. Everybody is locked up and locked down. Now, when you talk about this, is it the best system? Yes, it is, because we have no other means. Safe distance, keep yourself apart. It boils down to you and me. The government will do its own, but what of my role as an individual? I said one thing this morning. I said in those days, this is not the first time we have pandemics in Nigeria. In Nigeria. In those days, in the village where I grew up, you keep your house clean. The other man keeps his house clean, and the entire village is clean. But we know we're not taking even that responsibility and say, we're putting everything on government. Government says, wash your hands, do this. I know there are problems. You know, but there are ways we can keep ourselves along this in the safe distances. Are we not the same one clamoring, we want to go to market, we want to this? Is it not the same government that is opening because of Easter, opening churches and all that kind of thing? We're not serious in this country. We're not committed to this thing. Both the government and the people, we have a major problem. And it's going to continue to be with us until we become a disciplined nation. Disciplined government, disciplined people. That is what we need for this epidemic.
Discipline. Professor Tomer, I'd like to take your thoughts on vaccines, because I know you're passionate about vaccines and you've touched on it earlier. Once upon a time, Nigeria could produce vaccines even here in Lagos, like it's doing for animals in Vamjos. How soon do you think that the world can arrive at a vaccine for coronavirus? And let's just touch on that locally. Do you think that Nigerian scientists, such as yourself, researchers, can also come to that table to develop a vaccine homemade by Nigerians for Nigeria and even export, like we used to do for yellow fever?
That's the question. The first is, how soon do you think we can get a vaccine? It's going to take about 6 months to a year. because of the processing. You have to go through clinical trials and all those kind of things. It's not just getting the vaccine. It is testing in the first clinical trial, second clinical, and third clinical trial before you begin to use it on people. So we're looking at even the Ebola, it was fast track because of the problem. It still took at least a year to get it done. So we're looking at 6 months, 1 year, and the fastest to get a vaccine. Now let's come back to Nigeria. Can we produce vaccines? It will be the greatest dream, which will never come true because you don't have the environment to do it. Like what I'm saying, vaccine production, all those kind of things requires, you know, certain basic infrastructures. You can't run vaccine trial when you have no electricity. You can't run vaccine trial when your water is not running. You can't do vaccine production when you cannot guarantee where you're getting all your things from. You can run it. You cannot produce a vaccine when the government that you have does not care a hoot about what is going on in such situations. That's where the problem. We need to change attitude first and foremost. We need to get back, look back on this thing. What did we have in those days when we were producing vaccines? When you put somebody in charge of a place, he stays on that job. When you tell the gatekeeper that this is your job, don't let this animal go out, it will make sure the animal doesn't go out. Today, when you keep somebody in charge of people who escape from other countries, they will bribe them, go to their home and come back. Discipline, my friend. That is the number one. The environment that we are in, the electricity must be in place. So don't dream about vaccine production until you repair the same thing. Let me finish one point before I know you're running down. You're calling by the diaspora to come in. What would diaspora come and do? They are putting the cart before the horse. You repair the home first before you call the diaspora. The diaspora is not going to make the changes. When India and other countries did it, they first of all changed the environment of their country before their people were started going back. Now we want diaspora to come and turn the country around for us. Give them why did they run away in the first place? Because the environment was not conducive for them to work. And they're coming back to the same environment which has gone worse than what it was before the first time. So let's stop dreaming. Let's do what is right. This COVID thing should give us an opportunity in this country to sit down and think again back. What did we do in those days that we're very proud to be this country? A few days ago, somebody came in to come and give us a talk in Nigeria. I was looking across at that man. 30 years ago, that guy came into this country as a student, and I taught him how to do what he came back 30 years ago to come and teach me to do. That's the situation in my country. The expert of yesterday, the environment has become so toxic for us that we've become the novice of today. That is what your country is doing to you and to continue to do to us unless we think back and say, yes, enough is enough. Let's get back this country to what it was before. And we can do it. We did it before. I never studied outside this country. All my study was here in the remotest place of this country that you can imagine. But I could make my own because this country has standards. Let's go back to those days. Then we'll be lamenting about not producing a vaccine, not producing villages, not producing support.
Professor Tomori, there's a lot to take away from this interview, and we really do appreciate your presence on Arise Africa here on the Arise News Channel today. Much appreciated. Nigeria can do it, and we will do it. Well, let's now cross live to Abuja, the nation's capital, where Arise senior correspondent Chima Nwankwo gives us an update on happenings there. Hello, Chima, if you could hear me. I mean, coronavirus pandemic continues to wreak havoc globally, forcing governments to extend lockdowns or initiate lockdowns and further measures. In Nigeria here, the president extended the lockdown by another 14 days. What is the nation's capital reacting like this morning? What's the reaction?
I cannot hear you. Hello, I can't hear. I can't hear anything.
Okay, Chima Nwankwo, if you can hear me, just give us an update of what is happening. I see behind you is very busy. Where exactly are you? And tell us why it's so busy behind you.
Well, thank you so much, Adesua. I'm in this place they call Garki. Garki is in the Mpape area of town. Mpape is a suburb inside Abuja. It's in the heart of Abuja, but it's a suburb by itself. And basically around here, from what I've seen and what people have been speaking to around here, since the 14-day lockdown, not much has changed here. Yes, a few shops are shut here and everything, but so far, there is business has not shut down completely. And all those rules about social distancing, as you can see around me here, are not really being observed. A few shops have shut here and all of that, but like many shops here are still open. You can see commercial motorbikes here still carrying people as usual. So, like, nothing has really changed in Abuja. Not this part of Abuja, in Mpape area of Abuja. Nothing has really changed so far. Even though I have some people here right now who have said to me that that you know, things have changed during the lockdown. That it's not quite the same as it used to be. So, I'd like to speak with one of them now, who is just standing right here beside me. Hello. What is your name?
Yes. Yes.
What do you do?
I work. I'm a public servant.
Generally, how has it been here in this part of town for the past 14 days?
It's been terrible. It's been terrible. People don't find it funny at all. It's affecting everybody. It really affects everybody.
So what I can see, everything's been okay. I mean, like, people are going about their business and everything.
If you look around, you see shops locked down. It's only Okadas that move about. And people walk around too. But when it comes to business, nobody. If you look around, shops are locked. I think it's just it's because of the number that keep going up. That's why Mr. President have to increase the days too.
Can you say that again?
It's because of the numbers of the cases that keep increasing. That's why Mr. President, have to increase add another 14 days to make it look normal so that it will not get to everybody to avoid the spread of COVID-19.
But you know what I'm thinking about now is that, what I'm really thinking about is that there are people who make their living on a daily basis. They have to work to feed and all of that. I'm wondering how people like those are managing, you know, how they've managed for the past 14 days and how they're going to do for the next 14 days.
That is what is really affecting people. Because for you to sit down for 14 days and another 14 days being added again, I think people are not finding it funny at all. It's really difficult. It's difficult because when what you have in your pocket is always going out and nothing is coming inside. You keep spending till when you finish spending your money, then you have no choice than to move out by force.
Thank you so much, Felix. Thank you. So, like he was saying that, you know, the lockdown is getting really tight. And according to somebody I spoke with us earlier, just before I came on air, he was saying that actually that, you know, Nigerians have struggled to, like, maintain their balance for the past 14 days, and that now the pressure is really going to be getting tighter and tighter, and that the hunger is going to be getting real, because so far all the things that Nigerians have been buying, goods and services, food and all of that, have been things that have been stocked up in the past, have been stocked up by traders in the past. When supplies begin to run out, we're going to have a different kind of problem here. I also have somebody else I want to speak with now, another interview I want to take now. He has been here in Mpape, and he wants to talk to us now about what he's been going through. Tell me, first of all, what's your name?
I'm Geoffrey Boniface by name.
So tell me, how has it been now, these past 14 days?
Well, it have not been funny. People are passing through hell. Based on the lockdown, business are closed down. So it have not been funny.
So tell me, what do you think is going to happen next 14 days?
It's going to be worse than the way it was. Because this extension, people are going to see it.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot, sir. So basically, that's what's been happening here in the Papi area of Abuja. People are not finding it funny. Things are not easy. And from the looks of things, because cash flow, money is not flowing around, it's going to be getting difficult in the days to come.
Mm. Indeed, Chimamwako, it's quite a dilemma for any government, especially African countries who have to deal with weak health facilities and weak economies. Chimamwako Arai, senior correspondent from the nation's capital, Abuja, updating us on the extension of the lockdown. Moving away from that, President Muhammadu Buhari has directed the Ministry of Humanitarian Affairs, Disaster Management and Social Development to expand the social register by 1 million households within 2 weeks. Addressing the nation in a broadcast on Monday, the president says previous palliatives announced to ease the pain of the lockdown in Lagos, Ogun, and Abuja will be sustained.
I have also directed that the current social register be expanded from 2.6 million households to 3.6 million households in the next 2 weeks. This means we will support an additional 1 million homes with our social investment programs. A technical committee is working on this and will submit a report to me by the end of this week. The security agencies have risen to the challenges posed by this unprecedented situation with gallantry, and I commend them. I urge them to continue to maintain utmost vigilance, firmness, as well as restraint in enforcing the restriction orders while not neglecting statutory security responsibilities.
But some residents of Lagos and Ogun State are living in fear over attacks during the lockdown imposed by the government to check the spread of coronavirus. There have been reports of robbery in different communities in both states and in the last 3 days. Let's talk security now to top security analysts Kabiru Adamu in Abuja and Seyi Adetayo here in our offsite studio in Lagos. Join me now. But let me start with you. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining me, if I have both of you. But let me start with you, Seyi Adetayo. What do you make of the scenarios we've been experiencing in Ogun and Lagos, especially now that we have an extension of the lockdown?
Well, likely it is expected. If you're looking at the situation even before now, we understand that for us to announce a lockdown for a week or two definitely is going to affect lots of people that their life is dependent on the work they make on a daily basis. And though likely there have been lots of hues and cries that could not be confirmed, but that does not in any way erode the validity of those that are actually genuine. This has likely been traced to those that are one way or the other working with the National Union of Road Transport Workers. These are likely the people that are doing the daily collection of tickets that are no longer having that job to do. From what I've seen on the street, the videos I've seen, and those that I've physically experienced, I think they are likely the ones that are involved with this. I know there are discussions from right quarters as to addressing this, but the most important thing right now is that the security agencies need to re-strategize. Like what I saw happen in the last 2 weeks is a situation where you have the Nigerian police stationing about 20 to 30 personnel at a particular checkpoint. And with them, officers of the Road Safety Corps, Nigerian Civil Defense, and other paramilitary agencies. And the question is, why do we need 10, 20 police officers just to do a stop and confirm? What they are doing is not stop and check, just to stop and validate the identity of those. So this particular assignment can actually be carried out by other agencies. Why police don't need more than two officers working with those people at the stop and check points, and let the police actually go back into the streets and be able to make their presence felt, not on the highways, not on the major roads, but in the inner roads, where the people will see the presence of the police and they will have that respite. In my own community, we've been outside now for days now that we've been running vigilance, or let me say local vigilante, and it's been like that for so many days now. But yesterday night, the police were physically on ground. They patrolled like three times towards my own side, and people felt their presence. There was relief. In fact, people started going back inside into their various homes earlier than they used to go before. Why? Because they have seen the presence of the police. And that is what we need now. The presence of police must be felt, not on the major roads, not on the highways, but in the inner roads, in the suburb. When people see a police patrol team, even if it is once in a day, it will give them that desired comfort that they have actually been expecting or looking up to.
All right, let me take this to Kabir Adamu in our Abuja studios. Well, Mr. Adamu, you heard Sheikh Adetayo there. He says it's a matter of strategy. He says it was expected. But when you look at the response of Nigeria to curb the spread of coronavirus, do you get a sense that this was not all-encompassing when you look at the security component?
I think the overall strategy should have included issues around security, issues around human, development, especially the palliative component where missing. The presidential task force on COVID-19.
Problems with connection there. We'll get back to Kabir Adamu as soon as we can reconnect to him in Abuja. Mr. Sheikh Adetayo, let me bring back to you. You've said you have experienced this firsthand as you've had to set up local vigilante, even where you stay. But when you look at the response so far, I want to put that question back to you. Do you think that this was an all-encompassing, was it far-reaching enough a response to include security component?
Sorry, I didn't get that question.
Do you think that we did enough to take care of security aspects while we are curbing the spread of coronavirus?
Okay, I think the issue, like I said, it has to do with the strategy. It's not that the police are not outside. They're there. But it's about, re-strategizing, doing what will be, will have the desired impact. You say, at times, you think you're doing something, and it's all about all motion, no movement. Now, I've seen the difference in the last 24 hours now. And with the directive from the IG, and we could start seeing the effect right from yesterday. And I've spoken to quite a lot of friends, from living in different parts of Lagos and Ogun State, and they are attesting to the fact that there have been some changes since yesterday. And I think it's all about us sitting down, being able to evaluate and reassess the situation and say, oh, which approach will best address the situation that we are having at hand. No doubt that the people are hungry. Of course, on my own, I've done a lot in the last 1 week to support people within my own locality, and I know that a couple of people are doing that, and we still need to do much. See, where I feel that the problem started was the approach of the government ab initio. Government started it wrongly. When this issue came up, there was this fixation against the religious organization. And I listened to the last guest, the last segment that you had, and the man was talking about, giving a reference to Sweden and said this Sweden authority said their people are disciplined. The truth is this, when people trust the leadership, they will listen to you. You don't have to stress yourself. You don't have to deploy the police. So there is a problem of lack of trust with the leadership. Now, there is a leadership, or we have leadership in this country that people tend to trust most or more. Though we have some of them that appear to be treacherous, but despite this treachery, people still trust them. And that's the religious leadership. Whatever people might want to think, people believe in their pastors, they believe in their imam, more than they believe in government. And from the beginning, government focused negatively on the religious organization. There was this fixation about shutting down churches, shutting down mosques and the rest. Instead of first engaging them, having a buy-in of this religious leadership, they are going to be the one to voluntarily say, we are shutting down churches. They will engage their people and let their people understand. You see, an average old woman believes what his pastor is saying, than even what his husband is going to tell her, because they trust them so much. And that is what we will have expected. It's about us looking at the society, the peculiarity of our own society, and look at what worked most, what is more effective in our society.
Okay.
And it is still not late. Government need to go and re-engage those people. They've been having a way of reaching out to their people.
Mm-hmm.
They have a way of talking to these people. And this will not even, it will not... It's the what we're looking at is not even just limited to this. For some days now, I've been seeing churches, mosques, reaching out to the people, providing food to them.
All right, I hear that solution. Engage the authorities, the people trust the most at this time. But let me take it back to Mr. Kabiru Adamu from our Abuja studios. Great to have you reconnect with us. You want to land on that point because I asked you the question, did we get it wrong in planning this response as regards the security component?
The major missing point that I see is the absence of a model. The security itself would tell Nigerians that this is what the government, as it were, has put in place to ensure that all the likely fallouts of the pandemic response will be mitigated. My colleague, Shehi, has talked about some of these fallouts, and some of them, unfortunately, we're going to see over the coming days. So what model is government using? And by model, I mean what analysis, what assessment have especially the Office of the Security, National Security Advisor done? What has the Inspector General of Police done? What has he, that department, have they been able to identify the hotspots? Shehi talked about the National Union of Road Transport Workers. What of the bandits that are operating in some parts of Nigeria? What of the terrorists in the northeast of the country? So what type of assessment have we done using the models that the public security agencies have conducted? Then more importantly, has a simulation exercise been conducted to say, okay, this is where we are. And then when the socioeconomic impact of the lockdown starts hitting, this is what is likely to be expected. Mm-hmm. And these are plans to mitigate to be expected. So unfortunately, that aspect is missing from the current pandemic response government.
Okay, stay with us, gentlemen. Kabiru Adamu in Abuja and Shehi Adetayo in Lagos. We want to go on the streets of Lagos now where we have arrived senior correspondent Chukwumba Oyetunji. Chukwumba, where you are, what's the pulse like? What's the reaction to President Muhammadu Buhari extending the lockdown for another 14 days?
Thank you, Adesua. Good afternoon to you in the studio. We are on the street of Lagos, like you said, specifically at Mudupe roundabout here in Okera, Ogba area of Lagos. Of course, it's the first day of the phase two of the lockdown announced by President Buhari, you know, in Lagos, Ogun, and Abuja. And we're here in this area, neighborhood, to actually, you know, sample opinions of people on what exactly is going on. We got here this morning to realize that a few commercial activities, you know, are ongoing. Of course, people, it's a neighborhood market here. If you just look behind me, far, it's called, the market is called Mudupe Neighborhood Market here. People are coming in here to buy. And if you just look by my left here, people are, there's a meat seller who is attending to some customers. And by my right, there are some bike men who are moving people around in the neighborhood. I think people coming to the market to buy one or two things, one or two food items to actually feed themselves and their family members. But beyond that, Adesua, you know, the issue of security that has emerged in the last few days in some communities, in several communities in Lagos and Ogun State, is still a very major concern for the people here. Why I'm standing just by me here is the spot where community members, especially youth, that are lent, you know, were about 500 in number, gathered yesterday. This is one of the spots where they set up a bonfire. You know, people, youths from different communities, including the street by my left here is called Ondo Community. People from youth from this community gathered, joined with other people from Abuaba community. They all gathered to actually protect their community, against the ravaging criminal elements that have that are seizing the opportunity of the lockdown to actually, you know, attack homes, people, dispossess them of their valuables and all that. So by me here, I'm just at the junction of Ondo Street, and I have one of the community youth leaders who is there to actually talk to me about what they've been experiencing and what they are expecting, you know, for the next 14 days that the lockdown is going to last. Again, tell me your name, sir.
My name is Dr. Bright Omoniyi.
Dr. Omoniyi.
Yeah.
Let's start with the announcement. Of course, we need to keep the social distancing, you know, as advised by the health authorities for us not to spread anything, you know, across each other. You have been a youth leader around here.
Yes.
And the community I gathered have been members of the community have been, you know, out in the last few days forming vigilante groups to actually protect themselves against some youth, some miscreants who are breaking into homes and dispossessing people of their valuables. Tell me your experience as a leader around here.
For 3 days ago now, this is Okera community actually. 3 days ago now, there's no rest of mind concerning the soul boys calling them 1 million battalions. So they terrorize everywhere. We can't sleep. We are the one protecting ourselves. In this case, we call federal government and the state government to come to our aid. Like yesterday night now, there's nobody. We can't sleep till 4 o'clock before we go back to our bedroom and sleep. So we need federal government, the state government, to help us. Not only mobile police, not only police alone. We need military. So if they see military with us, so they will know that, we are serious. Even though, okay.
One of the community leaders telling me, you know, his experience, you know, in the last few days, how they've had to be the people watching over themselves because they think the police and the security agencies are not doing enough, and they are appealing to the authorities to actually send in more people that can, you know, that would ensure that they can go to bed with their two eyes closed. And well, the Inspector General of Police has just deployed a special intervention force led by DIG Peter Ayon Ogunyo. Yeah. Pardon me for not getting that name properly. I think that should be some kind of support for the people in this community and some other communities in Lagos and Ogun State. Adesua, I'll be handing over back to you.
Thank you very much, Tokunbo Etunji. You can only imagine the stress they are going through with security. But we'll take a quick break now and be back with Arise Africa Special. Join us again. Welcome back to the Arise News Channel. You're still watching Arise Africa, the special edition focusing on the coronavirus pandemic on the continent, especially here in Nigeria, Africa's largest economy. Well, I still have with me security experts from Abuja and Lagos, but let me bring in Arise News analyst Emmanuel Efeni to join this conversation. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good afternoon, Adesua.
A lot has happened, but let's begin with President Muhammadu Buhari's speech yesterday. For a lot of people, especially the health experts, they saw this coming. It would have been premature to see the president lift the lockdown. But what did that speech do for you as a political analyst first and as a Nigerian?
Well, the president speaking to Nigerians, we expected that to make a definite pronouncement on the state of the lockdown. And he has gone with the advice and recommendations of the experts that indeed we need to continue with the lockdown in order to contain the spread of the coronavirus. Some sharing news from that speech that indeed 92% of those contacts we are trying to reach we've been able to contact, and perhaps testing and the necessary isolation also follow. But if you look at the figure of tests carried out in Nigeria, still very poor, and Professor Tomori made that point that we are not doing enough tests in Nigeria. Perhaps that may be responsible for the low figures, but if you also look at the fact that from 131 cases positive cases at the beginning mm-hmm. of the first 14-day lockdown. Now we have 343. Yes, the rise is quite, you say, significant. But a country like South Africa testing as many as 80,085 persons, quite phenomenal. Ghana tested 37,954. And the Ghanaian figure quite interesting there, because out of that, mm-hmm. they've been able to, they have 566 positive cases. A number, majority of these were from surveillance testing compared to those who are travelers who were compulsorily isolated and tested. So we need to do this random testing also. We have to bring that into the fight to contain this COVID-19 virus.
All right, Emmanuel Efeni, stay with me. Let me bring in our security experts here again. Shehi Adetayo, I'll start with you in Lagos. You did hear from that respondent somewhere in Lagos talk about the military. And I'd like to bring that aspect into this, because there's the issue of people not adhering to this stay-at-home order or cessation of movement, like the president put it. There's also the issue of trust and compromise on the part of the policemen and the relationship between policemen and the citizens. Should we bring in the military here in 14 seconds? Do you think that would be effective in curbing this?
Capital, no.
Okay.
We seems to at times appear as a confused nation. On one hand, we complain about military excessiveness, using the military, bringing military into civil, you know, civil engagement. And on the other hand, we'll be the one calling for the military. We have the Nigerian police. We are not at war with ourselves. We are at war with a virus. So we don't need a military to come with guns to come and do this. You see, the problem we're having is that of engagement. If we have the right kind of engagement with the religious leadership, community leadership, the CDAs, the traditional leadership, we will be able to get desired level of compliance from the people. The people are willing to comply. But it's all about the way we're going about this. And I'm sure that when we decide to change the way, mind you, it is a lockdown and not a curfew.
Indeed. That is a good place to leave it, Shehi Adetayo. Let me bring in Kaveru Adamu very quickly in 40 seconds as well. The same question. Should we bring in the military? Would it be more effective and efficient?
No, I'm not in support of bringing in the military for civil security matters. Of course, it is a necessity in terms of the lack of available manpower from both the police and other civil security organizations. Then yes, we should bring in the military. And we've seen even democratic countries across the world bringing in the military. But if bringing them in, there should be a template for the of engagement. There should be a standard operating procedure that seeks to protect the citizen. Whatever they do, they should never harm any law-abiding citizen. And that is what is missing at the moment. That template, that standard operating procedure, will allow us to supervise their work, to ensure that erring officers are reprimanded, and of course they are subjected to whatever the law says whenever they abuse the rights of any citizen.
Indeed, a fine place to leave it. Kaveru Adamu, security expert from our Abuja studios, thank you so much. And Shehi Adetayo, who joined us from our Lagos studios. Many thanks to both gentlemen for coming on this special edition of the program. Very quickly, Emmanuel Efeni, let me come back to you. What was missing in that speech by President Muhammadu Buhari for you?
Well, the president talked about the palliative, getting to more people, 1 million more to be added. Mm-hmm. But the details of how to bring in another 1 million is not clear.
In 2 weeks?
Yes. And, well, we need to see how this will go around the country, not just Lagos, Abuja, and Ogun State, because most states have also declared lockdown. So we also need to reach beyond Lagos, Ogun, and the federal capital.
In 10 seconds, if you can, did you expect a national lockdown from the president yesterday?
Yes, I thought that should have been the way to go, because most states are already on lockdown anyway.
Okay.
But the president restricted them to 2 states and the federal capital.
All right. Thank you so much, Emmanuel Efeni. We'll go on a quick break and we'll be back to wrap up the program. Join us again. You're still watching Arise Africa special edition here. But away from COVID-19 pandemic, we must not forget that the Chibok schoolgirls were abducted 6 years ago today, April 14, 2014. Well, Aisha Oyebode of the Bring Back Our Girls campaign joins me now. Thank you so much, Mrs. Oyebode, for joining me. Very quickly, it's 6 years on. Is there still hope? Is there still light at the end of the tunnel for those girls we're waiting for?
Yes, hello, Adesua. There has to be hope. It's very important that we must remember. And, you know, it's something to say, oh, it's been 6 years and the trail is cold and time has gone. But no, in fact, this is the time when we need to really intensify the efforts. The girls have been away for too long. 6 years is way, way, way too long. And there have been windows of opportunity. Not so long ago, Shekau did release a video to say he was willing to negotiate and talk to us about the release of the Chibok girls. Just yesterday, the President of the Federal Republic also made a statement regarding what it is that they're trying to do with respect to ensuring the release of the Chibok girls. It can never be too late. Every single one of those remaining girls, 112 girls, must be accounted for. And with them, every other woman and girl that has been kidnapped by Boko Haram must be returned to us.
Communicate with the Nigerian government. Do you still get the sense of urgency, the sense of responsibility to rescue these girls and reunite them with their family 6 years on?
Well, I mean, if you go by the statement that was made by the president, yes, they are talking about it. But I think one of the things we need to move away from is an anniversary by anniversary remembrance. It's not a remembrance, it's not something that, the purpose of the anniversary is to remind everybody, but the issue of the Chibok girls should be a daily thing. It's not going to go away. 6 years is a long time for these girls to be away. I mean, we're talking right now about pandemics, we've had Lassa fever, we're having COVID. What condition do we know these girls are in? Is there adequate health care? Are they being looked after? These are some of the things that make it really, really urgent and imminent. We need to do something about returning the girls. So beyond thinking about it once a year, talking about it once a year, we need to be...
All right. Unfortunately, I tell you, but that's the much we can take. We'll never give up on the Chibok girls that were abducted. We'll keep the light shining for them and others who are in abduction by the Boko Haram insurgent. Thank you so much, Aisha, for joining us. Well, you have been watching Arise Africa here on the Arise News Channel. Please keep it here on the Arise News Channel. From the entire team here in Lagos, many thanks to you for watching. I am Adesua Omorwan. Goodbye.
That saved a wretch like me. Grace that taught my